We are so excited and so thrilled to have a very special speaker with us today. Captain Barrington Irving, some of you have already read his bio connected to our online webpage, but I'm going to read to you his official bio so you can get to know a little background on him before I bring him up to deliver the keynote. In 2007, and at the age of 23, Captain Barrington Irving became the youngest person and first black pilot to fly solo around the globe. He made this 97-day, 30,000-mile journey to show other youth that if he could achieve his dream, so could they. Since that time, Barrington has traveled to 50 countries, conducted more than 30 STEM expeditions, and founded a dynamic educational nonprofit, Experience Aviation. In 2014, he took flight again with his innovative Flying Classroom project, engaging thousands of students as they followed him online during an 8-week trip to 12 countries over 3 continents. He has a passion to explore, inspire, and educate others. Born in Kingston, Jamaica, and brought up in inner city Miami, Barrington was himself inspired to pursue aviation at age 15 when a Jamaican airline pilot offered to mentor him. He rejected college football scholarships to pursue a career in STEM and never looked back. A magna cum laude graduate of Florida Memorial University, Barrington was the recipient of a congressional resolution acknowledging his pioneering work in aviation education. He holds a Guinness World Record for his historic flight and was named a National Geographic Emerging Explorer in 2012. Ladies and gentlemen, prepare to be inspired and motivated. I want to introduce you to Captain Barrington Irving.
Wow, good morning, everyone. Oh, man, you guys don't sound excited. Good morning, everyone. All right, well, I'm excited to be here and to share a little bit with you all. My name is Captain Barrington Irving. Before I say anything else further, though, I'd like to recognize Helen and Sean, as well as the board members and leadership that provided me the opportunity, and Scholastic as well, who flew me out all the way from Miami, Florida to come here and share a little bit with you guys. So please, round of applause for them. So let's get right into it. We're going to the first slide. And let me see if the clicker will work from here. Let's see. I'll probably need your help. Hold on. Yeah. He just hit the forward arrow. There we go. All right. This is me when I was a kid. I was born in Kingston, Jamaica, and left at the age of 6 and grew up in Miami, Florida, and while growing up in Miami. If we go to the next slide, the one after this one, there we go. Thank you very much. So while growing up in Miami, I was a talented athlete. Here's a picture of me. I played for a school called Miami Northwestern Senior High School. At the time, we were ranked number one in the nation in football. I played fullback and linebacker. I was 197 pounds, 3% body fat, ran a 4.3 and a 40. And football was everything to me. That's honestly all I cared about. Until one day I was in a store minding my own business, and I bumped into this gentleman. Captain Gary Robinson. This guy walks into the store, dressed in his pilot's uniform, and I'm just looking at this guy saying to myself, man, this brother looks really sharp. And while I'm looking at him, he sees that, and he walks over to me and he says, hey, son, have you ever thought about becoming a pilot? My immediate response to him was, I said, sir, I don't think I'm smart enough to fly an airplane. But I asked them one pivotal question, and that question was this: how much money do you make? When he told me he made $117 an hour, I looked at him and I'm thinking to myself, I've never met anyone that made $117 an hour legally, right? I grew up in two of the three worst neighborhoods in Miami. That was Liberty City as well as Opa-locka. And Mr. Robinson, honestly, after meeting me, he gave me his phone number and said, hey, if you're interested, give me a call and I'll share more with you. So he began to mentor me. And as I continued to play football, so you're looking at it, it's my former high school teacher. Her name is Miss Batiste. Take a real close look at her face. When I was in high school, I absolutely couldn't stand this woman. Miss Batiste was one of those educators that required a high level of excellence. Here I am as an athlete, you know, you're used to getting away with murder as an athlete, and she was just one of those teachers that couldn't get away with anything. And in Miami, and of course all across the nation, you announce which collegiate team you'll continue to play for. And when signing day came, I decided to turn down my football scholarship to the University of Florida and said I wanted to pursue a career in aviation. Miss Batiste was the only person in my entire school who told me I was making the right decision. She became my mentor, and if it wasn't for this teacher, I would not be standing here in front of you. So in pursuing a STEM career such as aviation, my parents looked at me and said, well, you're the genius. Who's going to pay for school now? So I attended a local community college for a year, and then I started to volunteer because my mentor taught me the process of giving back. I remember when he said, son, I want you to give back, and I'm looking at him saying, I don't have any money to give. What could I possibly give back? And he taught me the value of sharing time, knowledge, experiences with others. And when I started to go down this path, the director of aviation from Florida Memorial University offered me a full scholarship that not only paid for a bachelor's degree in aeronautical science, but also paid for all of my remaining flight licenses. It was literally as if someone handed me a check for $150,000. And that simply came from volunteering. Now, I remember I was in my room and I was thinking about it and I said, man, what's something that I can do that just would be special? And having the ability to inspire others, I said, well, what if I flew around the world? For 2.5 years, people told me no. You're looking at one of my rejection letters. This one came from Coca-Cola. I'm glad they're not on the sponsor list, right? So this one came from Coca-Cola back in April of 2005. I sent a proposal that I wanted to fly around the world to inspire other children, and look what their response was to me. Here at the headquarters, we focus on events and programs that are national or international in scope when considering sponsorship requests. I'm sorry, well, what do you call flying around the world, right? You can't get more national or international in scope than that. So I realized people weren't understanding what I was trying to accomplish. And what you're looking at here in the next slide is my one pair of dress shoes that I own. Grew up very poor, and if you notice, I have 1, 2, 3 holes in the bottom of those shoes. Saved them till this day to remind me of where I came from. And I wore those shoes to major aviation events, such as this one, walking from booth to booth, asking people to help me fly around the world. Well, if you want to fly around the world, what's the first thing you need? An airplane. This was my first aircraft. This plane cost $650,000. How was a poor kid able to afford a plane that cost $650,000? Well, I quickly realized in this world, no one really feels sorry for you. And you have to figure out a way to earn it. So I remember, I was never a part of this in my community, but I saw it happening all the time. What happens when someone steals a car and the police can't find the vehicle? What happens to the car? Come on, this is LA, you guys should know. What happens to the car? That's right, I heard somebody say, it goes to the chop shop. I was just using street knowledge. When I saw that, I said to myself, just because you see one logo on the front of the car doesn't mean that company made all the parts. Because how it works is, you know, the stolen vehicle, they strip the vehicle and they sell the parts to different individuals. I just didn't know the professional term for these companies, and you call them original equipment manufacturers. I couldn't get any aircraft manufacturer to let me borrow or lease an aircraft. So I said, well, what if I went after each and every single manufacturer who made the individual part of that aircraft, asked them for no money, got them to just donate that part to me, and then build the plane on my own? Was a long shot, but I had nothing to lose. The first part I went after was the engine. I decided to drive from Miami to Mobile, Alabama, with only enough money to rent a car, put gas in it, buy a 12-inch sub, 6 inches first half a day, 6 inches second half a day. Brought plenty of deodorant with me because I couldn't afford to stay in a hotel or a motel. And I showed up on a Monday morning with a business suit on, and I said, hi, my name is Barrington Irving. I'd like to see if your engine is good enough for my airplane. Yes, I lied. But it got me through the door. They then gave me a tour, and I said, oh, the engine I want to put in inside of this aircraft, and that wasn't the real reason why I was there. I acted as if I knew who the CEO of the company was, and I purposely called him by his first name. I said, is Brian here? They looked at me and they said, which Brian? I said, Brian, who runs the company? They said, you know Brian? So I was prepared for this part. Before showing up there, I created a list of all the different conferences Brian attends. And when they asked me, do I know Brian? I said, yeah, I met Brian at this conference. I met Brian at that conference. I just want to catch up with Brian. That's all I want to do. Brian walks in, realized I tricked his entire staff. He was super upset, and he said he got a five-minute shoot. Within those 5 minutes, because I was speaking directly with the decision maker, I told him who I was, where I was from, and what I was trying to accomplish. I told him the truth. He simply said, thank you for coming, and I drove all the way back to Miami with plenty of deodorant. Received a phone call a few weeks later. To my surprise, it was Brian. Brian said, son, if you had the guts to find me, I believe you can find yourself around the world. And he sponsored me an engine worth $83,000. After getting the engine sponsored, because this was the one with the most liability, everybody else was like, okay, yeah, we'll help you out. I was able to get the cockpit system for $70,000, propeller for 20-some-odd thousand, four seats in the plane for $30,000. And I realized I had equity in the aircraft. Now, I understood equity from a street perspective, right? So I had to find someone at the airport to kind of mentor me through that process, and he co-signed for the aircraft, cut the cost of the plane from $650,000 down to $300,000, and by the age of 22, I was able to outsmart the aviation industry to get my hand on this airplane. This is what it looked like inside the aircraft. The suit that I'm wearing cost $15,000. It's a special survival suit. If I had to make an emergency landing in freezing water, this suit would give me 5 to 7 minutes to get myself out of the plane, out of the freezing water, and into a life raft. Back then, I did not know how to swim. Think about it. If you went down the middle of the Atlantic or the Pacific and no one's following you, swimming is not going to really help you that much. Although physically I was the only person in the aircraft, I worked with a team of 80 different individuals from Miami to Houston, Texas. This is the black box that I utilized to communicate with them. The youngest person to fly around the world before me was 37 years of age. And I was able to accomplish it at the age of 23 by working with some amazing individuals. Here's a picture of me in Cairo, Egypt. Notice anything weird about this picture? That's right, I'm sitting on a horse instead of a camel. Why am I sitting on a horse instead of a camel? I asked a group of elementary students this question. Young man in the back of the classroom raised his hand and he said, "Sir, I know why." He said it with a stern face. I said, "Tell me why." He said, "Sir, that's what Americans do." I said, "No, that's not the real reason why I'm on a horse instead of a camel. Let me tell you why. On the day I departed to fly around the world, I only had $30 in my pocket. No one knew this. That's all the money I physically had in my pocket. But I strategically knew once I departed, people would begin to believe in the mission, and more funds were actually raised towards the project. The entire project cost $1.2 million, but I had to be frugal with every single dollar I had, and that's why I'm sitting on the horse instead of the camel. After flying around the world and setting a Guinness World Record, I'm excited and so forth, and then a teacher had to mess it up. Teacher wrote in a letter to me, and she said, "Barrington, I want to thank you for inspiring my students. My shower curtain was of the world, and I took down the shower curtain, brought it in the classroom, and I marked all the different locations you were traveling to. Thank you for inspiring my students, but I need you to empower them." This woman made me feel so good and so bad at the same time. But she was right. So, not having an educational background, I said to myself, what is it I can do? This was the first project we did. I challenged 60 kids from failing high schools in Miami to build me an aircraft from scratch. This young lady, Bakari, when she started out with me, can point out a half an inch or a 16th of an inch on a ruler. She's now in her senior year on a full scholarship as a math major at Duke University. This young man, when we had cleanup day, it took him 2 hours. His name is Aaron. It took him 2 hours to figure out how to turn on a vacuum. He thought the red button on the vacuum meant do not touch. Now he's disarming bombs for the military. Thank you. So while going through this, I'm saying to myself, there's no way a high school student should know where a half an inch is on a ruler. What's the problem? So I then decided to work with middle school students. Instead of buying a Ferrari 430, I had kids build me a car faster than one. This was built by kids between grades 5 through 8, all from failing schools in Miami, and they did it in 6 months. We then started to experiment more. This is a build that was done in Dallas, Texas with middle school students. Here's another one that was done in Houston, Texas with Latino students. This program, they were trying to figure out a way to attract women and minorities to their automotive program. We did this car build with them, and after this car build was done, they have a backlog of over 230 some odd students. So I'm saying to myself, what's the difference? I realize a few things. Number one, students don't care about the journey, they care about the destination. Remember the question I asked my mentor, how much money do you make? You know what I was really trying to understand when I asked him that question? What will my life look like if I went down this career path? The largest sales force in this nation are educators. But here's one of the things I've noticed as an entrepreneur from the outside looking in. The education industry is one of few industries that honestly has no clue of how to communicate to its customer. Think about it. Apparel companies, cell phone companies, everyone else knows how to engage Your children accept the one industry that should know it the best. So in seeing this, I said to myself, we have to do a bit more. Here's another car. This is how all the car builds start. And this is one going on currently in Atlanta, Georgia. And when they're finished, this is what their vehicle will look like. In realizing that young people have the potential and so forth, I went back to Ms. Batiste, remember my former high school teacher who I can stand, and I said, Ms. Batiste, I want to do something with curriculum and learning that's a little bit different. And before I could even say anything, this is part of the reason why I can't stand Ms. Batiste. Ms. Batiste said to me, Barrington, I don't care what you do. Just know this, all you have is 15 seconds. Like, what is this woman talking about? If you can't engage my classroom in 15 seconds, I've lost them for the entire period. She was right. So we decided to create a project called the Flying Classroom, which is a curriculum that we designed for elementary and middle schoolers. Not every child will have the opportunity to build an airplane with me or a race car. So we said, well, what if we transform the business jet into a real-life magic school bus, and instead of Miss Frizzle, you got a brother flying the plane, and you travel to different parts of the world exploring STEM, or if you want to say STEAM, we just say STEM plus. That way we don't leave out anyone. And what if you just did that? If you saw something amazing today, do you know how long it will take to be converted into curriculum that will reach your classroom? How long does it take? Someone said 5 years, that's correct. 3 to 5 years. What industry can wait 3 to 5 years for innovation? Here's another issue we have with STEM. Hot political word, a lot of funding behind it. What is STEM? I asked a group of teachers this question, what's the difference between STEM and science? Teacher raised their hand and said, well, one has math in it and the other one doesn't. This is a challenge we're dealing with. In the state of Florida, where I'm based, 83% of math and science teachers have no professional background from those fields. Is it their fault? No. I graduated as an aeronautical scientist. Can I teach on biomedical engineering? No. Can I teach on regenerative medicine? No. So why isn't it products aren't designed in a way where you don't have to be a subject matter expert in order to share STEM with your students? This is what we wanted to tackle. That's my co-pilot, Tom. We travel a little bit higher than airlines. We travel at an altitude of 45,000 feet, 530 miles per hour on average. If we had rapid decompression in this aircraft, what would happen to the human body? You'll explode outwards because of the nitrogen. See, these are the things kids love to hear. You go fast, you could blow up, you could kill yourself. When you talk about engagement, we traveled to every continent except for Antarctica so far. This is what it looks like when you're flying an aircraft in the middle of nowhere and you can't see a thing. Trying to find a runway that's only 300 feet wide. When I was in school, I honestly used to hate decimals. I was one of those students who felt like if you got the first four numbers correct, who cares about the other six, seven, eight numbers? Well, in order to do something like this, every single point counts. Let me know if you see the runway. I show that to the kids, they're like, oh yeah, Mr. Irvine, those decimals real important, Mr. Irvine. Let's look at this. How do you bring a subject such as bacteria to life? Well, we decided to spend 48 hours eating out of the dumpster. I worked with this gentleman, Rob Greenfield, who's actually located in San Diego. And within our first 48 hours of eating out of the dumpster, we found 500 pounds of food. A little bit over 500 pounds of food. Of the 500 pounds of food, only 19 pounds of it was spoiled. Here's a video of me and Rob Greenfield visiting the first dumpster.
Right there? Uh-huh. Open top, filled to the brim.
Uh-huh.
That's dumpster gold right there.
Those are two words that just don't go together, dumpster and gold. So you can tell I'm a little bit embarrassed. I got a hat on, I got shades on. I'm walking around with a guy with no shoes, eating out of dumpsters.
I feel a little bit
embarrassed a little bit. This was done here in California.
Let's check this out.
I see you've got mushrooms.
Oh, look at this.
Tomatoes.
Look at this.
You want to grow your own basil? Organic bananas shipped all the way from Peru to end up in our dumpster. Oh, check out this strawberry.
Get all that food. So this was actually done in San Diego. I won't say the grocery store. I think it was Sprouts grocery store. And this was our first dumpster. Imagine you're an educator and you want to bring the subject of bacteria to life. What child wouldn't want to see you eating out of a dumpster? The average grocery store throws out 250 to 500 pounds of food a day. In our breakout session, I'll talk a little bit more about this experience and the engineering design challenge we did associated with that expedition. Here's another one. What's so special about this shoe? I think I heard someone say it. No, I didn't get out of the dumpster. It's 3D printed. What's so special about 3D printing? There's a time to learn about a career, and there's also a time to learn about an industry. 3D printing is going to revolutionize manufacturing in the same manner the video camera revolutionized journalism. Why is that important? We wanted to bring this to life, so we went to Nike's headquarters and we highlighted one of the first ever 3D printed shoes. Nike has figured out a way where no longer will you have to go to a department store to purchase a brand new pair of shoes. Mark my words, within 5 years, you'll have the capability to 3D print a brand new pair of shoes at home on a 3D printer and walk out of your house with them on your feet. This is where technology is going. Let's go to the next slide. This is one we did in Bali. Oh, yeah, I guess I skipped that one by miss. All right, I'm not gonna mess with it. So, I'll skip the Bali. Okay. All right, I think it's good. So this is one we did in Bali. In Bali, they do what's called dynamite fishing. They take a stick of dynamite, throw it into the ocean. We wanted to bring to life the whole aspect of saving our coral reefs. So I take a stick of dynamite, throw it into the ocean. It explodes. The fishermen are able to easily capture the fish. However, when the explosion occurs, they end up damaging the coral reef. So we decided to work with scientists, artists, and engineers that figured out a way to build sculptures, place them on the ocean floor, cemented in bio rock. But one of the things they do that's special is they wire electricity to the sculptures. They figured out if you wire electricity to the sculpture, it will actually accelerate the growth of the reef. Here's another one we did in Israel. Teachers asked us to bring the digestive system to life. So I traveled to Israel and swallowed this camera pill, and students received a virtual tour of my digestive tract. Y'all looking at me like, this brother's crazy. This is what inside my intestine looks like. But you talk about engagement. You talk about creating a platform where it makes it easier for you to share the vital information with your students. This is what it looks like when you don't take care of your body. Notice the difference. Some of you guys looking like, oh, I shouldn't have drank last night. Notice the difference. Here's another one we did. This is happening here in the United States. Anyone know about the industry of regenerative medicine? Few hands. What are we going to do, wait 5 years to learn about this? This is here. This is now. We worked with this gentleman, Dr. Atala. After studying salamanders, he figured out a way to save the lives of human beings by 3D printing and growing a kidney as well as a liver. Mark my words, by the end of this century, we will not need an organ donor except for the brain. What Dr. Atala realized is that you don't have to get the organ to 100% functioning capacity. You only needed to get it to 10%, because the human body is naturally designed where if the organ is at a 10% capacity, the human body will restore that organ and do the rest. This one we did with the bionic chef. One day this guy was out hunting for food, saw a dead bear lying on the ground, didn't realize what killed the bear was a down power line. Took out his knife, went to touch the bear. Of course, the knife acted as a conductor, and when he touched the bear, 2,400 volts of electricity went through his body. Immediately burned off 4 of his ribs and blew off his arm. You share this story with a group of elementary school students, you're like, oh, that is so cool. The very same thing that almost killed him kept him alive. The electricity was so hot, it sealed his skin back together after it exited his body. He was able to get up and walk for 3 miles to get help, airlifted to a hospital. Then they fitted him with a bionic forearm as well as 2 bionic hands. Now when he's in the kitchen, whatever he thinks about, his bionic hand understands between his brain and the remaining sensory nerves left in his arm. His bionic hand understands and is able to perform the function in synchrony with his other hand. This is on the field of biomedical engineering. Here's one we did in Palau. This one was done with the sea snake. In Palau, the sea snake is viewed as a god. We were not allowed to bring any anti-venom with us. If this snake bites you within 45 minutes, you do not have the strength to breathe on your own. Do you know from this snake you can teach kids about DNA? Let me show you why. What you're looking at is footage of a sea snake eating an eel twice its size we were able to capture. Scientists have figured out there's a genetic arms race between the sea snake and the eel. With each and every single birth, the venom from the sea snake is slowly getting stronger, and the resistance from the eel is getting stronger as well. At this point, is the eel dead? Nope, it's paralyzed. The venom from the sea snake disconnected the signal from its brain to its nervous system. So scientists said, well, if you can turn the switch off, can't you turn it back on? It was at this point I started to swim backwards. Because I thought it was barking at us. A sea snake spends half its life on land and half its life in the ocean. Because it swallowed something twice its size, it was simply burping to release the air. Here's a picture of us taking blood directly from the heart of the snake without killing it. There's the head of the snake. Here's the heart of the snake. And that's a picture of us taking blood from its heart without harming the snake or killing it. What scientists have figured out is that if you alter the venom as well as the DNA, you can fight against heart attacks and heart disease to save the lives of human beings. This actually works. This actually works. There's tons of research documenting the impact of this. But think about this. What would this do to the medical industry? Here's a natural cure. This is one we did in Jellyfish Lake, one of my favorite pictures. Do not ever attempt to swim with jellyfish. Won't discuss the science behind it. This one was done in the Amazon a few months ago. One of my teammates almost lost his life. We were looking for a different type of snake in the Amazon that lives on the floor of the jungle. It's known as a lancehead viper snake. Does anyone see the snake in this picture? You see it right here? Yep. Nope, it's not there. Just wanted to see. Here's the snake right here. What was waiting for us, there's a close-up of it. This is what was waiting for us, 7 feet long. I've never seen a snake other than the king cobra that looks like it does push-ups every single morning when it wakes up. But this snake can also save lives as well. Of course, you come across other creatures as well that can help human beings. This was sad to see in the Amazon. A lot of deforestation going on, and we were in a quote-unquote pristine area of the Amazon in Peru. Of course, you take in certain cultural experiences. That was in the Wailing Wall in Israel. And of course, people ask me, what's the weirdest thing I've ever eaten? Here you go. This is known as fruit bat soup. The only thing good about fruit bat soup is the coconut sauce they put it in. The hardest part about eating fruit bat soup is cutting the hair off the bat, off the meat, in order to eat it. Took me 3 hours to eat this. I was with a royal family. What am I going to say? Oh, I'm allergic to bat? I'm American. They know I've never eaten bat before. But these are the type of things that become learning opportunities for children. I'll show you a quick video clip of, this was in Dallas, Texas, when we visited one of our schools via helicopter.
Check it out, that's Lancaster ISD Superintendent Dr. Michael McFarland arriving at George Washington Carver STEM Learning Center. And a helicopter is joined there by Captain Barrington Irving, who's the youngest person and first black pilot to fly solo around the world. Pretty cool stuff, right? Today kicks off the flying classroom curriculum for students at the STEM Learning Center there. It allows students to travel the world without ever leaving the classroom.
That is so cool. I've always wanted to arrive in a helicopter.
You're big time if that happens.
Shopify.
So, anyway, that's my contact. Let me put it this way. Look, I started off with 3 holes in the bottom of my shoes, and to me, I couldn't see the meaning behind STEM. And the reason why is no one ever painted the picture for me of what the finish line actually looks like. Here I am today, and I'm truly grateful for all the educators that have sown seeds in my life. And just know, I used to be a difficult child when I was in school. A lot of teachers thought I was never paying attention to them. But if you can change the way we inspire young people and engage them, learning becomes fun and more easy for them to accept. Thank you guys so much for the opportunity. Thank you.